Welcome to EPG Pathshala. In this particular module, we are going to do contemporary women's movement in India, which is part of the course on gender and social work. I am Dr. Shuli Kumar, Associate Professor, School of Social Work from Tata Institute of Social Sciences. The topics that are going to be discussed in this particular module are Introduction to Contemporary Women's Movement in India, Levels of Feminist Movement, Definition of Social Movements, Beginning of Women's Movement in India, The Milestones, and a summarization of the entire module. The contemporary women's movement in India has a historic roots in the earlier period before the freedom struggle. Contemporary women's movement began in 1975, and till present it continues to engage in various different issues and problems and different strategies. It's pretty diverse in terms of its locations. It plays an important role in terms of bringing gender issues in the public domain and also in the process of development planning and policy making, as well as defining feminist politics within the country. The movement has progressed through social reform movements, nationalism, and the freedom struggle. And whilst the reform movement at that point of time addressed specific issues of women like sati, women's education and early marriage, child marriage and widow burning, during the national movement, feminists also engaged in the whole notion of women's rights and how that those get located within the national freedom movement and later into nation building. The efforts were progressed through the formation of different women's organizations. Essentially, the women's movement developed through different women's organizations, which were promoted and propagated by different women leaders and groups. And the strategies were agitations, campaigns, networks, and development of networkings, which also changed the lives of the women activists themselves as well as the women leaders themselves, and informed the various constitutional guarantees and legal frameworks that were adopted by India after the national movement and gaining of freedom of the country. The definition of social and feminist movement, maybe we should understand so that we know what we are talking about. Social movements can be defined as an organized set of constituents pursuing a common political agenda of change through collective action. Social movements comprise of the various constituencies who emerged through their own oppressions and who start questioning those oppressive ideas. They can be catalyzed by different activists and theoretical frameworks, and through that process different strategies are adopted for change, where there can be agitations, there can be rallies, there can be dharnas, but these are all done through collective action, and then they form into a bigger process of change in any given society. Together with social movement, feminism and feminist ideologies informed the feminist movement or women's movement in India. Feminisms are varied and different as ideologies, analytical frameworks, and strategic frameworks. Some of the feminist ideologies emerge from women's own experiences and as collective experiences, and some have emerged through the ideas of the Western feminist theoretical frameworks and understandings, specifically during the national movement. And as an ideology, feminism today stands not only for gender equality, but also for transformation of all social relations of power that oppress, exploit, or marginalize any set of people on the basis of their gender, age, sexual orientation, ability, race, religion, nationality, location, class, caste, or ethnicity, etc. According to Lee and Banaszak, there are different levels in feminist movements, which is important for us to understand. Any study of women's movement needs to focus on multiple levels of a movement. The micro level explores individual activists and their interactions, and as I mentioned, sometimes movements emerge from the ground, from the grassroots, in response to oppressive conditions which are there existing in that particular context. And so at the micro level, people come together to engage against this oppressive condition. And from there, it can progress to the meso level, which examines the contextual structural discrimination that is existing, or structural oppressive conditions through groups and institutions. And they can be either spontaneous processes, or they can be organized based on discussions, debates, coming together in consultative processes, and with the interaction, their interaction move forward towards a larger movement. The macro level looks at an eclectic mix of challengers as a coherent whole. So sometimes what happens that a movement against price, high prices, can begin in a small location in a town or a city, and then it spreads out to larger states, and then becomes a national level movement at the to engage with the state and to engage with institutions which decide and dictate what the prices of particular commodities should be. The term feminist movement, therefore, is also used for women's movement, because feminisms inform the women's movement and the trajectory that women's movement takes in given context. The beginning of women's movement in India is began in during the 19th century. The social reform, the historical embeddedness of this women's movement was in the 19th century, where the social reform movements took place, but they were largely male led, and they were women participated in these movements, but were not really the leaders in this movement. They went on to then engage with the nationalist movement of the earlier 20th century, where freedom became the clarion call for the entire Indian nation, and the civil liberties movement at the later 1970s. But it also engaged at the grassroots level struggles simultaneously, where different groups demanded land rights and demanded access to water resources, or demanded freedom from discrimination and caste oppression, as in the Ambedkarite movement. The social reform movements, of course, looked at age at marriage for girls, prohibition of sati, widow remarriage, and education of women. However, this was not adequate, and these were largely male-centric efforts. And during the national movement, women's engagement from different walks of life became sharper. A lot of women were educated in the Western mode of system of education, and yet they understood the notion of freedom, and they incorporated it from the ideas and experiences of their own lives, and therefore the demand for rights for women specifically emerged as part of nation building and nation building processes, and got embedded in the constitutional guarantees for equal rights for women, as well as universal adult suffrage for women, which was really pathbreaking for India as a country, because the Western world was still struggling at that time for ensuring universal suffrage for women. So in many ways, the women leaders during this time brought in a great deal of different dimensions and issues which needed to be addressed, which then facilitated the development of women's movement in the later stages during the 1970s, 80s and 90s till date. Moving forward from the nationalist movement, with the heavy involvement of rural women in the famine agitation from 1971 to 73, including the Naxalbari movement, where women were in the forefront using different instruments to engage the police and the state stakeholders for demanding land rights and right to food security, which were largely informed by the socialist and the communist women leadership. Then, as well as the urban women's anti-price movement, all these were informed a great deal by the socialist ideologist and socialist feminist frameworks. Then there were the Dalit movements. The Ambedkarite movement has had a strong Dalit women's following, and they imbibed the ideas of social justice, caste discrimination, as well as the tribal movements. These were some of the diversities that existed in the society, and the oppressive structures were very different, and the experiences of women within these locations were also very different. So these movements were in many ways organic, coming emerging from the nationalist movement and the ways in which knowledge got percolated to women within these constituencies, within these women. In 1927, it's important for us to remember that these small these bodies which were constituencies played a constituted were played a very big role in the later movements that happened in India and continues to inform the movements till date. These were Women's India Association, the National Council for Women's Women in India, which is largely an elite women's group, and the All India Women's Conference, which has a great deal of socialist understanding and has also percolated to the grassroots in cadre building of women rights activists. A path-breaking step that was taken post the national movement, which was very critical and important milestone in the women's movement, is the detailed report of the status of women in published in India in 1974. Which adopted, this is a committee report which added fillip to the need for focusing on women's issues in India. The committee report was path-breaking because it did not just concentrate on the issues of child marriage or women's lack of access to reproductive rights. In fact, it looked into the socio-economic structures of oppression and the disparities that exist in terms of women's education, in women's status in education, also in the workplace and where all they are working, and the lack of workplaces for women, the economy, the society, and also the political arena, the absence of women in political decision making. All these dimensions in its comprehensive framework, the report was able to highlight. This led to a whole lot of engagement, discourse, and the need for further coming together of women to ask for remedial measures and programmatic interventions from the state, and equality for women became very critical. This also led to the formation of women's studies, which was something which so far had not been thought about. So women's studies as a separate discipline of inquiry and research and academic engagement was institutionalized post the publication of this particular report. The issues of women and the movements that are there in the contemporary context and continue to inform further mobilization of the women are that violence against women had been increasing despite movements and mobilization and programmatic interventions. Violence against women continued to rise, and there were cases of rape in police custody, wife murder, that is what bride burning or dowry deaths on a large scale, and sexual harassment in workplace and on street continued to escalate. Women's issues entered the fields of culture, religion, and law, and because of engagement of women's movement and women's studies, and it was understood that no space can be free of inquiry into women's issues. Therefore, women, the culture, religion, law, politics, all required women-centered understanding. So family and community structures were deconstructed, examined for structural violence. Problem of official responses to population control were questioned. Poverty, illiteracy, and labor were seen from a women-centered approach, and gender inequalities that were embedded in it. And new social movements by Dalits, environmentalists, tribals, anti-dam activists, peasants, and trade unions were also critiqued, questioned, and gender concerns were incorporated within these movements. So that was something that that became critical, as Rajeshwari Sundararajan has said, that post independence and actually 50 years of independence, all discourses and disciplines decided to incorporate gender concerns within their own work that they were doing. However, whether that's really true or not is a question that still needs to be answered. But gender did become a flag bearer in most discourses that emerged from the grassroots as well as in the policy and programmatic interventions by the state. Women also engaged with other movements, as I mentioned, so I'm just going to talk about a few where women became part of it and then questioned how gender gets located and how women participated and yet were not given rights. So some of these other movements are the Tehbaga movement, the Telangana movement and the Naxalite movement. Interestingly, Beena Agarwal has highlighted that while women participated and were in the forefront in the demands for land rights in most of these movements, when it came to actual policy and rights devolution, women were marginalized when land rights were given to men in men's name, and women were actually just relegated back into the household work or the domestic reproductive care work that women used to do once upon a time. So in many ways, it did get what the women really wanted, but it did bring into forefront women's agency and leadership. Another such a movement was a tribal landless laborers movement against landlords in Shahada. And Shahada movement also, increased women's leadership in this whole process. And they were able to make their voices heard and continue to participate in different ways even today in other movements. Women also played a prominent role and led demonstrations, invented and shouted militants. So when women engaged or mobilized, they had their own ways of mobilizing. So they used different slogans, songs, many creative ways in which their militancy developed and their organization develops. So that was a unique phenomena which they brought into other social movements and made them very visible and vociferous, and the state had to respond to some of these demands which these movements were asking for. The anti-alcohol movement has always been highlighted as a women's only movement, and the ways in which women actually engaged with was also unique in terms of, you know, women breaking pots of arak or publishing various posters and songs and doing night patrolling so that alcohol was not consumed. And in fact, they questioned and challenged the state to withdraw many of the alcohol licenses given to different panchayats and urban municipalities so that these shops could be closed down because they were impacting women and increasing violence against women within the private realm. Some of the milestones of women's movements, especially contemporary women's movements, is important and need to be highlighted. In 1980s, there was a great deal of mobilization, women's mobilization against rape, and this was triggered by a judgment of the Supreme Court in which it acquitted two policemen who were accused of raping a minor tribal girl in a police station, despite the fact that the High Court had indicted them. There was a general outcry and a complete agitation by all women's organizations and groups, because it was felt that this was extremely unfair, and four eminent lawyers addressed an open letter to the Chief Justice of India protesting against this injustice and this whole connotation of rape being based on violence, physical violence being inflicted, and that the whole issue of consent being debated upon. So the law was changed finally in 1983 through sustained not just mobilization and action, but also through advocacy and research and various demands being given to the state to change that particular law. Groups also took up campaigns against dowry. This was something that was critical, and it was like a societal canker which was creating a lot of difficulty for women, and there was a lot of violence inflicted against them through demands for dowry. And several groups like the Sri Sangharsh, Sri Bhukti Sangathana and Mahila Dakshita Samiti came together to create consciousness raising against dowry and also push for an anti-dowry act, so that more and more women could redress and have some kind of legal recourse where they were being harassed and violated through demands for dowry. So this was something very critical that happened during the 1980s and 1970s and 80s. Some of the other, which is also a milestone as well as something that is has contemporary relevance, is the Shabanu's case, wherein as a Muslim woman, demanded maintenance from her divorced husband because she was living in utter penury. Supreme Court judgment gave that she was entitled to this maintenance, and that the Sharia law cannot be upheld as giving maintenance only for the iddat period. However, there was a great deal of outcry from the Muslim fundamentalist groups, and they said that Supreme Court or the law of the land cannot interfere in the personal laws of the country, a debate that continues even today, because there is an understanding that there needs to be a uniform civil code, but this has never been really done because religious fundamentalist groups do not want to see women's rights being devolved in the different religious groups. So there is always a backlash when such a judgment is given, and so 1985 the women's movement did face a great deal of setback when the Orthodox Muslims said that this was interference in their personal laws, and there was a backtrack that was done, and instead of being able to ask for justice in this section 125 CRPC, the Muslim Women's Protection of Rights in Divorce Act was evolved, which adhered to the Sharia law and did not really ensure that Muslim women could apply for maintenance in section 125 CRPC. So that became a bit of a problem and continues to be engaged with by the women's movement to see how this particular law can become gender friendly. The efforts of Ila Bhatt in setting up of the Self-Employed Women's Association was another movement where she unionized the women workers in the informal economy, and it led to the Shram Shakti report, which looked at labor rights and rights of women workers to unionize. So this was of course discussed and debated. However, it did not, though Seva continues to exist and similar such collectives have been set up to ensure that women get unionized. However, in today's context, there are several problems in terms of trade unions taking up women's issues and gender equality rights within their context. A crucial step that has been taken since 1980s from protest politics towards political mainstream is something that we still need to acknowledge, that a transformative process has begun, at least at the level of the state. And the state now talks of gender equality and also talks of gender mainstreaming and participation of women in all its programmatic interventions and policies. So there are consultative processes with different organizations and movements when new policies and programs are thought about. So in that way, the state has at least acknowledged that it's critical to engage with women's issues and incorporate gendered understanding and gender equality within many of its policies and programs. Another perhaps achievement of women's movement has been to ensure that the local grassroots democracy becomes gender friendly and gender equal, with the 73rd and the 74th amendment of the constitution for reservation of women within the local governance structure. So this has been achieved, and despite the fact there are critiques of how it works, however, it is important to remember it is an opportunity, and many of the women are able to articulate at the local levels the concerns of women specific issues and needs, and including violence against women. And many of the movements have utilized this law to ensure that Dalit women's voices and marginalized women's voices come into the forefront within the local governance processes. So it is an opportunity available to women's movement to make grassroots democracy stronger, more gender equal and gender diverse. Another outcome of the women's movement has been growth in academia. Women's research on women's issues, and also being able to ensure that there are women's studies programs in almost all universities, is something that has given fillip to women's issues and advocacy with empirical research, advocacy, lobbying, and ensuring that state policies become gender friendly. So women's studies spread to India slowly at first, and then more rapidly following the UN mid-decade conference in Copenhagen. The Indian Association of Women's Studies is firmly established since 1981, and every 3 years or 2 years, all women academics and activists come together, share their experiences, and it forms a huge platform for ensuring that all new women's issues are addressed and researched, as well as activism and movement is taken forward in different ways in the women's movement. In formal politics, interestingly now, most of the parties have women wings, which includes Congress, BJP, CPI, CPIM, and even though in some cases they may be just token representation, there are opportunities and possibilities to engage with formal politics, and women's movements representatives and activists always continue to have a discourse and dialogue with most of these women's wings. They are dispersed now, however, with no central organization, but they have built informal networks at both the states and the local politics levels. So wherever there are possibilities, they are able to come together, whether they are leftists or they are liberal. Less so liberal, but more leftists are available at the grassroots level. So women's movements have also dispersed, and there are smaller groups available in at the grassroots level democracies, and also at the specific state level political party processes. The Indian women, however, has often been accused of being urban based and middle class by other movements. So that tension and discourse and debate continues, and there are those occasions and instances where Dalit movement questions the women's movement by saying that Dalit women's realities don't get articulated by the larger women's movement, and vice versa, where women's movement says that, you know, Dalit women's issues are not addressed in the Dalit movement, and similarly with other different ethnic groups and marginalized groups. But this discourse is also vibrant, and the mobilizations continue to inform the Indian polity and the Indian larger society overall. It is also important to remember that while women's movement in India continues in different ways, it may seem that it has become a little silent, but technically what has really happened is that it has not remained a monolith, and different issues have brought forth different women different women activists, different organizations to address these issues, and it has remained responsive to critical times and moments in this society. For example, the aftermath of the Nirbhaya case led to the setting up of the Justice Verma Commission and changes in the laws on violence against women. Similarly, the Bharatiya Muslim Mahila Andolan is spearheading the abolition of the triple talaq for Muslim women, and it has considerable support from the larger women's movement, and tacitly they continue to process and support in different ways the work that Bharatiya Muslim Mahila Andolan is doing. So it is not something that one says that, but it's that women's movement is not apparent, but it's reinventing itself and it's moving into different trajectories using technology, internet and various other variety of shapes and forms to continue to engage on contentious issues. This module therefore brings out the iteration of women's mobilization on differing issues, also the diversities and contestations and connections in women's movements in India. It is not really comprehensive. The module is not comprehensive. It has not brought in all the women's movements the way it is located within the Indian context today. But it needs to be supplemented with continuous reading and engagement in the field. It cannot be, comprehensively put together. So it is submitted that regular readings of new processes where women's movement is spearheading different issues in the framework of the law, in the framework of the polity, and also in the society needs to be kept in mind while examining women's movement in India. Thank you.